10 in that way. So it's befitting that you split the young boys and the girls from that age. As for toys of children, children's toys, then it's befitting that they are not toys which are upon a clear and apparent shape of dolls, something which has been carved and structured in the shape in that manner. Except that which has been mentioned concerning, or the Sheikh says that it was the example of what you have now, Barbie dolls and things like this. Except what's been mentioned concerning Aisha, radiallahu anha, ايش كانت عندها؟
لعب البنات بنات يشبه يعني على صورة بنات لعب على صورة بنات لكن يقول علام الباني على عمل البيت مثل الاسفنج تكومه كالرأس وليس نحت كالباربي الآن
except for Aisha radiallahu anha she used to have this type of doll but Sheikh Al-Albani he said it's what you just make generally from household items. You get something, maybe like a sponge or some other item like that, and you generally shape it into like a figure, maybe put some small item or clothing on it, and that's a general type of doll. Not what we see now, like these Barbie dolls and other things, which are clearly upon the shape of a human, clearly carved out. That's not the meaning of that narration from Aisha. And it's been mentioned that the ones who try to imitate the creation of Allah, they are the most punished on the Day of Judgment. The Prophet said that the most punished of the people on the Day of Judgment are the ones who try to imitate creation. So the meaning isn't those clearly made out dolls like Barbie, but a general something you make out of household items which imitates a doll.
وكذلك الاحتفاظ بصور البنات الصغار والكبار. فلا يحل لأحد أن يستعمل الصور الفوتوغرافية للذكرى كان يضعها في ألبومات فهذا حرام. فمن كان عنده ألبوم صور قديمة لبناته الصغار يجب عليه أن يحرقها ولا يدعها في بيته لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تدخل الملائكة بيتا فيه صورة فمن أراد أن يطرد الملائكة من بيته فليضع في بيته الصور وإذا قال أنا أضعها في الألبوم فنقول له إنك ستضعها للعرض نعم قال ابن حزم وإذا عرضت الصورة طردت الملائكة ولا يجوز طرد الملائكة نعم.
Also, the Sheikh says something which is not befitting is that you keep pictures, photographs, for memory purposes. As the people, they do now, they make albums of pictures of their children, their daughters when they were young, and then they keep these albums for memory's sake. So this is something which is not good, and rather they should be burnt, these kinds of pictures, if you have them. Because it's been mentioned in the Sunnah that the angels, they do not enter a household that has pictures within it. And so the Sheikh says, if you want to expel the angels from your household, then keep these albums of yours. Otherwise, they need to be gotten rid of and burnt. And it's mentioned that when a picture is brought out, whenever a picture is brought out, then the angels, they are expelled as a consequence. They go, they leave as a consequence of these pictures.
أو تضعها في الفيسبوك مثلا, أو تضعها في الجوال, أو تضعها في أي مكان, إلا الضروري منها. كما قال علماء كصورة الجواز وصورة الرخصة وما لا بد له منها أما ما سوى ذلك فلا يجوز كما يقول علام العثيمين لا يجوز الاحتفاظ بالصور للذكرى أول شرك ظهر في الأرض بسبب الاحتفاظ بالصور للذكرى كما في صحيح البخاري من حديث ابن عباس أنه لما احتفظوا بود وسواع ويغوث صورهم وأصنامهم جاء جيل عبد هذه من دون الله.
Or similarly, saving these pictures and these photographs on the computer, like similarly saving these pictures on the computer, like Facebook or on your mobile phones, that all of this is impermissible. But except if there was a need or a necessity, like your passport or like some other type of license, some of these licenses you need pictures on them. So other than these things, then it's not permissible. These things are for necessity. And Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen, he said it's not permissible to keep photographs for the purpose of memories. Like they have these albums for the purpose of memories. That's not permissible. And it's been mentioned, as we know from the Sunnah, that the first shirk which occurred upon this land was the shirk at the time of Nuh alayhi salam when they had those imitations of their righteous people. Wad and Yaghuth and those. When they had the imitations of those righteous people, the pictures of those righteous people. And then as Ibn Abbas, he mentioned after that, the next generation they came and they didn't know what those pictures were about and they began to worship them. So this was the way that the first shirk actually occurred.
فإذا قلتنا علمنا ما أعظم ما نهتم به بأولادنا قلنا أمر التوحيد والعقيدة كما فعل يعقوب عليه السلام ماذا قال يعقوب أم كنتم شهداء إذ حضر يعقوب الموت إذ قال لبنيه ما تعبدون من بعدي قالوا نعبد إلهك وإله آبائك إبراهيم وإسماعيل نعم وإسحاق إلها واحدا ونحن له عابدون. نعم فعلموا أولادكم التوحيد. ما هو التوحيد؟ هو إفراد الله بالعبادة وهو معنى لا إله إلا الله. هل معنى لا إله إلا الله كما سمعت جماعة أحد جماعة التبليغ وهي جماعة حرم العلماء الخروج معها كالعلامة الألباني وبن باز والعلامة الفوزان والغديان وغيرهم من كبار العلماء، قال لا يجوز الخروج مع جماعة التبليغ لما هم عليه من البدع. نعم يعني يقصدون. فقال لي أحد جماعة التبليغ معنى لا إله إلا الله لا خالق ولا رازق ولا محي إلا الله. قلت كلا، لو كان هذا معناها لما حارب كفار قريش رسول الله، فإنهم لما علموا وهم عرب أقحاح أن معنى الإله المعبود، فعرفوا أن النبي لما قال لهم كما في سوق ذي المجاز قولوا لا إله إلا الله تفلحوا، علموا أن النبي يريد منهم أن يكفروا باللات والعزى ومناة الثالثة الأخرى، أي لا معبود حق يذبح له ولا ينذر ولا يخاف منه إلا الله. فمن قال في دعائه يا رسول الله كما ذهب إبريث بالمدينة يقول يا رسول الله اشفع لي عند الله، فهذا مشرك مخلد في النار. فيعلم الولد التوحيد وأنه لا يذبح إلا لله ولا يقسم إلا بالله، فلا يقول والنبي وحياتي وحياتك، كل ذلك ينبغي أن يعلم. ولا يقول لولا مهارة أبي، وكان أبي سائق جيد وهو يصف كيف أنه نجم الحادث، لولا أبي ومهارته لسرنا صار حادث، يقول هذا شرك. قل لولا الله ثم أبي، يعلم في منطقه كما كان النبي يعلم الغلام فيقول له كل بيمينك، نعم كل مما يليك، علم الغلام النبي فعلمه التوحيد من باب أولى. كذلك علم الغلام ابن عباس قال يا غلام إني معلمك كلمات، كلم الغلمان على أنهم كأنهم كبار حتى يتعلموا ويفقهوا. فقال النبي له إني معلمك كلمات، احفظ الله يحفظك، احفظ الله احفظ الله تجده تجاهك، يعني قم بحدود الله سبحانه من الأمر والنهي، يحفظك ويسلمك من النار ومن الشقاء في الدنيا ومن الحوادث. قال احفظ الله يحفظك، احفظ الله تجده تجاهك، إذا سألت فاسأل الله، وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله، وعلم أن الأمة لو اجتمعت على يضروك بشيء لا يضروك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله عليك، ولو اجتمعوا على ينفعوك بشيء لا ينفعوك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله. انظر كيف علم الرسول التوحيد لابن عباس، ويعقوب كيف علم ابنائه التوحيد. فينبغي أن تعنوا بهذه القضية، تعليم الأولاد التوحيد والعقيدة. نعم.
So if the women are then going to say after all of this, then what is the most important thing that we should be paying attention to with regards to our kids? Then the Sheikh says the most important thing that you should be paying attention to is the affair of Tawheed. Teaching your children the affairs of Tawheed. Just like Ya'qub. Ya'qub alayhi salam, when he was dying, he said, as is mentioned in the Quran, he said to his children that
مَا تَعْبُدُونَ مِنْ بَعْدِي قَالُوا نَعْبُدُ إِلَهَكَ وَإِلَهَ آبَائِكَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ.
He said to them, what will you worship after me? Who will you worship after me? This is what he said to them at the end. And they said, we will worship the Lord of our forefathers, the Lord of Ibrahim and Ishaq, etc. I, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one Lord alone, and we will not worship other than that. So this was the final statement of Ya'qub to his children, the affair of Tawheed. So teach your children the affair of Tawheed. And that is to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with worship. Is the meaning of Tawheed what the Jama'at al-Tabligh they say now? And the scholars, they've already said, like Sheikh Al-Fawzan, Sheikh Ibn Baz, they've already said that it's not permissible to go out with the Jama'at al-Tabligh because of the errors that they are upon. But is their meaning correct of La ilaha illallah when they say that the meaning of Tawheed is that there is no sustainer other than Allah, and there is no one who gives life and death other than Allah, and there is no one who creates other than Allah? Then the Shaykh said, when one of them said this to him, he said to him, never. That's not the meaning of La ilaha illallah. And if that was the meaning of La ilaha illallah, that there is no creator and giver of life and death other than Allah, then the mushrikeen, they wouldn't have fought against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they wouldn't have expelled him. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to the Suq dhil Majaz, and he was saying to the people, قُولُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا تُفْلِحُوا, say La ilaha illallah, there is no deity worthy of worship in truthfulness except Allah, and you will be successful. They knew what he meant. They knew that he wanted them to disbelieve in all of the other gods and deities they had. Al-Lat, wal-Uzza, wal-Manat. These other things they worshipped, they knew he wanted them to prevent themselves from worshipping any of that. So they knew the meaning was singling out Allah with worship. Not just to say that Allah is the creator. Then now you have other examples of individuals. They go to the Prophet's mosque. And then they'll say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at his grave, "Oh, Ya Rasulullah, intercede for us on behalf of us with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Intercede on our behalves." And this is a type of shirk which exits a person from Islam. So other things that you should teach your children also. Teach them, for example, that when you make oaths, you make them by Allah. So you don't say, "I swear by the Prophet." And you don't say, "I swear by your life," or "I swear by my life." These kinds of statements are incorrect. And you don't, when it comes to the issue of, if only. You don't say, for example, that accident occurred, and was it not for my father, then we would have been hit or whatever. Rather you say, was it not for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, firstly, then the good driving of my father, whoever, we were saved. So even statements like that, to say that it was because of the good driving that I protected myself from that accident, is incorrect. Rather you say, it's because of Allah, and then after that, the good driving that you did. So these kinds of affairs are all from the affairs of Tawheed that they need to be taught. Then after that you have other affairs also, like the manners of eating and the other parts of the Sunnah. And the Prophet ﷺ, he taught Anas, and he said to him that come and I will teach you some words. And he said to him that احفظ الله يحفظك, that protect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, i.e. the rights of Allah, and Allah will protect you. And احفظ الله تجده تجاك, that if you protect the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will find him in front of you. And if you ask anyone, then don't ask anyone except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you seek aid and assistance, then seek that aid and assistance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And know that if all of the people they gathered to do some harm to you, they would not be able to do that harm except if Allah decreed it. And know that if all of the people they gathered to do some good to you, they would not be able to do it except if Allah decreed it.
والآن وقبل أن نستمع إلى الأسئلة نأمر النساء أن يتقين الله سبحانه وتعالى في العلم، فهو الذي يحرسهن من الآفات الدنيوية والأخروية، من ضيق الصدر في الدنيا وفي الآخرة من النار. قال ابن القيم: من أسباب شرح الصدور طلب العلم، وضده الجهل، فهو الذي يتسبب في كوارث ويتسبب في ضيق الصدر وهمه وغمه. فالله يحب أهل العلم وطلبة العلم، ويبغض الجهل سبحانه، ولا يحب الجهل ولا يحب أهل الجهل الذين يستطيعون العلم ويعرضون عنه. فلتكون المرأة في بيتها مكتبة صغيرة سمعية وإيش وورقية. أما السمعية فتأخذ شروح التوحيد، والحمد لله يعني يمكن أن تأخذها من نسخ من محاضراتنا التي أجريت في مسجد السنة في شرح التوحيد، وإن شاء الله نكمل معهم رحلة بعد رحلة كتاب التوحيد كاملا إن شاء الله. ويمكن أن تأخذ كذلك صفة الصلاة للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من العلماء المعتبرين سماعا وكتابة وغير ذلك مما ينفعها، شرح شروح كتاب التوحيد وأشرط العلامة الألباني إذا كان هناك مترجم أو ترجمت إذا استطاعت. وأما المكتبية فتأخذ شروح كتاب التوحيد، شرح كتاب التوحيد، تفسير القرآن لابن كثير مختصرا مثلا للمبارك فوري أو غيره، مختصر كتاب تفسير ابن كثير ونحو ذلك. وتتعلم اللغة العربية، ينبغي أن تحرص المرأة على أن تعلم اللغة العربية لتفهم القرآن. تدخل معهد لغة أو تتعلم اللغة العربية من طريق الانترنت أو غير ذلك حتى تفهم، والله يعينها على ذلك. وأسأل الله أن ينفعنا وإياكم ما سمعنا وتعلمنا، وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.
And the women, they should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to the issue of knowledge. Because know that knowledge is that which protects you from the tightness of the chests, i.e. the difficulties that occur in this lifetime, they are from the lack of knowledge. So it is this knowledge that protects you in this dunya, in this world, from these difficulties and calamities and hardships and grief. And in the hereafter, it protects you from the hellfire. And Ibn Qayyim, he said, from the reasons that a person's heart is content and serene and tranquil is knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, via this knowledge, causes the opposite of tranquility, this tightness and this difficulty and grief to go away. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the people of knowledge, and He loves knowledge, and He does not love the people of ignorance. So a woman, she should make for herself a small library. A library which has audio material within it, and also written material within it.
وَلَا تَضَعْ فِيهَا كُتُبْ أَهْلَ الْبِدَعِ
كَسَيِّدْ قُطُبْ وَالْغَزَالِي وَالْقُصَّاصِ كَعَايَضَ الْقَرْنِي وَسَلْمَانَ الْعَوْدَةِ وَإِنَّمَا تَضَعْ كُتُبْ أَهْلَ الْعِلْمِ كَالشَّيْخ بِنْ بَازِ ومن قبل كذلك الإمام أحمد والعلامة بن تيمية كتب السلف ومن دل على دين السلف وليس كتب القصاص الذين لا يعرفون الحديث موضوع من غيره لا تضع في مكتبتها هذا التخليط ليكون دينها نقيا.
And then the woman, she should have this audio file, audio material and written material. So from amongst the audio material that you could possibly take now is, for example, some copies of the lectures that have been going on recently in Masjid al-Sunnah, the explanation of Kitab al-Tawheed. And the Shaykh says, inshallah, in the future the journeys, we will complete the explanation of Kitab al-Tawheed. So you could take those recordings and listen to those which have been translated. And also the explanation of the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which were delivered by the Shaykh, also translated. And other than that, from the cassettes of the scholars like Shaykh al-Albani, if there is something there which has been translated. Similarly, from the books, then you should get the explanations of Kitab al-Tawheed also. And other books like Tafsir ibn Kathir, or the summary of Tafsir ibn Kathir by Al-Mubarak Furi. And it's upon a woman also that she learns the Arabic language, so that she can understand the Qur'an, and she can understand via that the Sunnah, and know the methodology by knowing the Arabic language. But in this library of hers, which is audio and written, she should have the books of the Salaf, the books of the scholars, not books of the storytellers, and these people of innovation like A'id al-Qarni and others. They don't differentiate between the authentic narrations and the non-authentic narrations. Not people like that, the innovators, but books of the Salaf like Ibn Taymiyyah, or before Ibn Taymiyyah, Ahmad, and then books of the scholars like Ibn Taymiyyah and others that, other than them. These are the books that she should have.
الأسئلة تفضل. السؤال الأول. قول كوشين. قول لهم. قول لهم بدأت الأسئلة.
We're going to do questions and answers now.
سائلة تسأل تقول بنتي عمرها 15 سنة دائما أمرها بالصلاة وبعض الأحيان حتى الضرب لكنها تحب أن تصلي مرة ولا تصلي مرة وكانت تصلي نعم لما كانت صغيرة ما الجواب؟ الجواب نقول بارك الله فيك أيتها الأم الفاضلة لأنك شابهت أو اتبعت في عملك إسماعيل عليه السلام وكذا أمر الرسول عليه أفضل الصلاة وتم التسليم واذكر في الكتاب إسماعيل إنه كان صديقا نبي إنه كان رسولا نبيا وكان يأمر أهله بالصلاة قال عنه وكان يأمر أهله بالصلاة فعملك في أمرك ابنتك بالصلاة قد علمه الله سبحانه وتعالى والله شكور إذا عمل العبد عملا صالح شكر له ذلك بإنشراح الصدر والبركة في الرزق وغير ذلك وضربك قد صادفت فيه السنة لأن النبي قال وضربوهم عليها لعشر بعض العلماء قال هذا يدل أن من ترك الصلاة كبيرا يقتل لأن الضرب بالعشر طيب إذا بلغ يعني يستحق القتل لكن واصلي معها النصيحة والضرب ونحو ذلك والحرمان من المتع والأشياء التي تحبها حتى تصلي حتى تصلي فواصلي معها ذلك نعم وليؤدبها أبوها أيضا ولا يكون التأديب منك فقط بل أدبيها أنت وليؤدبها أبوها ورغبيها ورهبيها واذكري لها الموت وعاقبة تارك الصلاة ونحو ذلك نعم.
The question says that I have a daughter who's 15 years old and I always tell her to pray and sometimes even I even hit her. However, she doesn't like to pray. Sometimes she prays and sometimes she doesn't pray. And she used to pray when she was younger. But so what do I do now then? So the Shaykh says that may Allah reward you for your action. And you have a similarity to what Ismail alayhi salam, what's mentioned concerning him, and the command of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in your actions. So it's mentioned concerning Ismail alayhi salam in the Quran, the meaning of which is Allah says that he used to be, or he was a messenger, a prophet, and he used to, وَكَانَ يَأْمُرُ أَهْلَهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ. He used to command his family with the prayer. So you have done this. And also the command of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that he said that hit the children at the age of 10 and above if they do not pray. So again, you have met that too, that you have hit her, that she doesn't pray. This is correct also. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is grateful for those slaves who do these good actions. Allah is shakur. So this is good that you do these actions. And the scholars even said that the fact, just as a side point, that the fact that you are allowed to hit your children at the age of 10 if they do not pray, it indicates that when they get older than that, when they are beyond the age of puberty, they are older, it indicates they should be killed if they don't pray. That's one of the evidences they used. So the Shaykh says, continue with your advice to her, and it shouldn't just be you, but your the husband also, the father. He should give her morals and manners, and tell her what she needs to do, and she has to pray, and continue advising her, warn her about death, warn her about the punishment of the one who doesn't pray, but continue upon this way.
واذكر في الكتاب إسماعيل إنه كان صادق الوعد إنه كان صادق الوعد وكان رسول النبي. نعم اقرأ. كيف لنا أن نقوي إيماننا؟ هذا سؤال جيد. أهل السنة مجمعون على أن الإيمان يزيد بالطاعة وينقص بالمعصية. نعم يزيد بالطاعة وينقص بالمعصية، ويزداد الذين آمنوا إيمانا، فإذا كان يزيد فهو ينقص، فإذا كان يزيد بالطاعة فالذي يقوي الإيمان طاعة الرحمن ومجاهدة النفس على تحصيل الطاعة. قال الله تعالى والذين جاهدوا فينا لنهدينهم سبلنا. فتقوية الإيمان يكون بطلب العلم والعمل به، وقراءة القرآن وتدبر معانيه، وقيام الليل وصيام النهار، وطاعة المرأة لزوجها وكفها بلسانها عن المعاصي. فلا بد عند زيادة الإيمان من تخلية وتحلية. تخلية أن تجاهد المرأة نفسها عن ترك الذنوب فيزيد إيمانها بمجاهدة نفسها بترك الذنوب، فإذا تركت الذنب وهي تريده زاد إيمانها، وإذا أمرت بطاعة ففعلتها تريد بها وجه الله سبحانه وتعالى فإنها يزيد إيمانها بذلك. والسؤال الثاني، نحن ندرس اللغة الإنجليزية، هل نذهب إذا تكلمنا مع الرجال؟ أنا لا أرى، نعم هل نذنب، فلا نرى للمرأة أن تخالط الرجال في الأنترنت عبر الماسنجر أو الفيسبوك أو غير ذلك، إلا إذا كنا مجموعة نساء يدرسنا عند شخص من 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 وراء حجاب، فلا حرج إن كان متمكنا في ذلك. أما أن يكلمها وحدها لتقوي إنجليزيتها تكلمه في الفيسبوك أو تكلمه في الماسنجر، هذا ما يجوز. فينبغي أن تبتعد المرأة عن أسباب الفتنة. والله قد قال الله تعالى يا أيها الناس كلوا مما في الأرض حلالا طيبا ولا تتبعوا خطوات الشيطان إنه لكم عدو مبين إنما يأمركم بالسوء والفحشاء وأن تقولوا على الله ما لا تعلمون. نعم.
And the question says, how can we increase, how can we strengthen our iman? So the Shaykh says that Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they are agreed upon and consensus that the iman, it increases with obedience. Iman increases with obedience and it decreases with disobedience. And the Shaykh mentioned the ayah in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that meaning, that the ones who believe, their iman is increased. So in order to increase your iman, you have to increase your worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And another ayah the Shaykh mentioned, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينا that whoever, the ones who strive in our pathway, upon our obedience, etc., then we will guide them the pathway further. So actions like recitation of the Qur'an, and pondering over its meanings as well, not just recitation, also standing in the last third of the night and praying, or just standing and praying in the night. Also obedience to the husband, and stopping using your tongue for the for any type of disobedience. So there are two things. Again, you have the takhliya, which is to remove from yourself all of those things which are evil, their sins and other things like this. Remove them and purify yourself from those affairs, and that increases your iman. Especially if a person, or if a person wants to do a particular sin and his soul is being dragged towards that particular sin, if he leaves it, then that's a cause for his iman to be increased. And similarly, the opposite, that if a person is commanded to do some type of worship and he does it, seeking the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that increases your iman also. The second question is, the sister says, we study the English language, we study the English language, so are we sinning if we speak with men? We study the English language, so are we sinning if we speak to men? So the Shaykh says that we don't see that the women should be mixing with men on Facebook or the internet and these affairs. If, for example, it was a group of women sat behind a screen, then and there was someone who is grounded in knowledge teaching them in that manner behind a screen, then that's okay. But on Facebook in this manner, for women to be mixing with men alone, with the reason of learning the English language and speaking to them, then this is incorrect and this shouldn't be done, it's not permissible. And then the Shaykh, he mentioned the ayat from the Qur'an that do not follow the footsteps of the shaitan, indeed he commands you with evil. So this is the answer concerning that you do not mix with the men in learning the language.
نعم عندي أربع أطفال. تقول السائلة عندي أربع أطفال والمدارس المسلمة بعيدة والإمكانيات ضعيفة، هل يمكن إدخال الأولاد في المدارس الإنجليزية لأن مجبورون قانونيا على إدخال في المدارس العامة؟ نعم، أنا لا أرى أن يدخل الولد حيث يظل عن دين الله سبحانه وتعالى في مثل ذلك المكان الذي يعلمهم سيء الأخلاق ونحو ذلك، فلتصبر المرأة مع ابنها حتى يفرج الله عنها سبحانه وتعالى، فليدرس، نعم، فليدرس دراسة منزلية عبر الانترنت مثلا، ويدرس وينتسب انتسابا بحيث أنه يأخذ شهادة إن قدرت، وإلا فالإمام أحمد رحمه الله ما عابه أنه ليس عنده شهادة، فالله عز وجل لو إذا علم خوف المرأة على ابنتها بتركها أو ابنته أو ولدها بتركها إدخاله مثل هذه المدارس التي تعلم الأخلاق السيئة من الاختلاط والموسيقى أو غير ذلك، سيجعل الله لها الفرج والخير والبركة في أولادها، وحينئذ من ترك شيئا لله عوضه الله خيرا منه.
The questioner says that I have four children and the Muslim schools are very far away and our means of transport etc., our capabilities are weak. So is it possible for us to put our children into the English schools with the knowledge and knowing that it's obligatory upon us, we're compelled to have to put our kids into these general schools, these state schools by law? So what do we do in that situation? The Shaykh says that I don't see it befitting that you put your kids into these the state schools whereby they will go astray and go astray from the religion of Allah by putting them in such state schools where they teach them evil manners and bad manners, and they have other things like music and these affairs which are sins. Rather, a woman, she should be patient, she should be patient herself and with her kids until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives her some opening, gives her some relief in some other way. So for example, now this child can be taught at home, this homeschooling system, or somehow like we have the open universities in university, but some sort of system where you can still learn with a school you're associated but without having to go there, and you can still get your degrees or your qualifications. But otherwise, the Sheikh says, Imam Ahmed, for example, no one criticized him just because he never had qualifications. So the Sheikh says those kinds of places where they have these evil acts and this music, etc., then it's not befitting that you should try and put them there, but give them the homeschooling and otherwise. And then the Sheikh said at the end that whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah, then Allah will substitute that person for something better. Whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah, then Allah will substitute him with something better.
أعوذ بالله. ولذلك تأثر رجل في عندكم في لندن اسمه
أسامة حسن
تأثر بنظرية داروين فيقول عياذا بالله أن أصل الإنسان قرد، وهذا باطل. قد خرج البخاري في صحيحه من حديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال خلق الله آدم على صورته طوله 60 ذراعا، يعني لم يتطور في الخلق حتى يقول أن أصل آدم قرد. إذن خلقه على هيئته طوله 60 ذراعا، وقال الله تعالى إن مثل عيسى عند الله كمثل آدم. فإذن عيسى عند الله أليس كان له أم؟ فأراد الله أن يضرب مثل بآدم أنه ليس له أب وليس له أم، فكيف يقول هذا اللي يسمى إيش حسن
أسامة حسن
أن آدم أبوه قرد؟ نعوذ بالله. ثم كيف هذا يحب أن يكون نسيبا أو حفيدا للقردة، وإنما يعير الرجل بذلك، والمشكلة أنه يخاصم في ذلك. لا تكلمون على جدي قرد.
Then the brother just added a point to the previous question about the state schools, and he said that in the state schools from a young age they teach them these deviated methodologies like the evolution theory. And so the Sheikh said that's correct, and now you've seen what's happened to this individual Usama Hassan, who has started making these comments about the evolution theory and Adam alayhi salam. And the Sheikh says, look at Sahih Bukhari, the hadith is there where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that خلق الله آدم على صورته طوله 60 ذراعا. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam upon his image. He was created as he was, and his height was 60 cubits. So Adam alayhi salam was created as he was, his original form. Not that he was created in some other form, originally something else, and then this evolution occurred, or this development occurred, and then eventually we came to Adam alayhi salam, and the original state was monkeys or whatever else. This is incorrect. He was created upon his form, as Bukhari says in that hadith, or as Bukhari narrates in that hadith. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also gave the example in the Quran that the example of Isa alayhi salam is like the example of Adam alayhi salam. So Isa alayhi salam, he was born with a mother but without a father. So how, the Shaykh says, can this individual now come along and say, we request from the sisters that try and listen, try and control your children, etc., try and keep it quiet, and let everyone benefit, inshallah. So then the Shaykh says, how can it be that this individual now states that the father of Adam alayhi salam, or what came before Adam alayhi salam, was monkeys or other than that? This evolution theory that he states. And the Shaykh says, how can anyone be pleased that he thinks that his grandfathers were monkeys or whatever else? Is anyone pleased to say that about himself?
طيب، لا شك في السؤال عن آل بيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. نعم، لا شك أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أمر بحسن العهد بآل بيته. نعم، وأذكركم قال الله في أهل بيتي أو كما قال، فهذا يدل على بقاء نسل النبي، أقصد بقاء آل بيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وهم بنو طالب وبنو عبد المطلب رضوان الله تعالى عليهم. نعم، فلا يأخذون من الصدقة، ولهم من الاحترام أكثر مما لغيرهم ما دام أنهم من آل البيت، لكن بشرط أن يكونوا صالحين. طيب فهم بنو طالب وبنو عبد المطلب. أما من ذكرت السائلة جعفر ونحو ذلك فأنا لا أعرف نصا في ذلك الآن، لا أحفظ نصا. نعم.
The question was asking that who is Ja'far and Aqil? Like when we say concerning the Prophet ﷺ that I will, when the Prophet ﷺ said, I will tell you about my family, and it was mentioned amongst that the family of Ja'far and the family of Aqil, and then the family of Abbas and the family of Ali, etc. Who are Ja'far and Aqil? The questioner says, and the Shaykh says that we say that the Prophet ﷺ told us about how we should behave with the family of the Prophet ﷺ, the household of the Prophet ﷺ. That should be a good behavior between us and them. And also what's mentioned concerning the fact that the descendants of the house of the Prophet ﷺ are still present, and they are Banu Talib, the children of Talib, and the children of Abdul Muttalib. So those families now, the ones who remain, they are not allowed to take charity, and they have a greater degree of respect with the condition that they are righteous. The righteous from amongst them, they have that condition. As for Ja'far and Aqil, then the Shaykh says that he doesn't recall any text concerning them now.
لا أنا الآن وقفت على سند يدل على ضعف الرواية التي جاءت فيها، لأني لا أعرف الرواية الخاصة فيهم. نعم يا رسول الله إن أم علي وجعفر قد ماتت، المهم يحتاج إلى نظر. نعم.
So the affair needs to be looked into more detail to find out the reality, the details of this issue.
نعم. شوف. تقول السائلة يا شيخ هناك عندنا كثير من شباب وشابات عندهم شيء من الغلو في الجرح، هم يزعمون أن هذا من الدين، فهل من نصيحة؟ الجواب عن هذا أن الله بنفسه نهى عن الغلو في الدين، ومن الدين جرح الرواة بما هو فيهم، فلا يجوز الغلو في ذلك. قال الله تعالى يا أهل الكتاب لا تغلوا في دينكم، والغلو هو مجاوزة الحد في الدين، كمن يتوضأ 5 مرات ونحو ذلك، فكذا الذي يجاوز الحد في الجرح. قال شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله وقد ينطق العالم من مجتهدي السلف بالبدعة لحديث صحيح لحديث ضعيف يظنه صحيح ولتأول مرجوح يظنه راجح ولا يكون مبتدع. فإذا كان مجتهدي السلف بما أظهر التوحيد والسنة قد يتأول فيقع في البدعة، ومع ذلك لا يجوز تبديعه والتشدد والغلو في جرحه حتى يسقط كما يفعلون مع الشيخ عبيد الجابري والشيخ ربيع وغيرهم. ينبغي هل لا يجاوز الحد في ذلك، فإن الشيطان له مع ابن آدم واديان، واد من الغلو واد من التقصير. واد من التقصير في هذا الباب أن يقول له لا تجرح أحد كالإخوان المسلمين، يقول إذا جرحت أحد تفرقت الأمة، هذا تقصير. غلو أنه يجرح العالم بما يحصل من تأول عنده والخطأ، ومع أنه يظهر التوحيد والسنة والرد على أهل الأهواء ويكون عدين السلف، فهذا يجرحه بالخطأ أو البدعة والبدعتين. فقال الذهبي لو بدعنا العالم بالبدعة التي تأول فيها والبدعتين لبدعنا أناس مثل ابن مندى أو فوق ابن مندى. نعم، بل ينبغي اتباع أهل العلم في جرح الرواة، ولا يتصدر الشبان والشابات في التكلم فيهم، بل يمسكوا ألسنتهم وليطلبوا العلم، هذا خير لهم.
The questioner said that lots of the youth from the men and the women, the youth. The questioner says that many of the youth from the men and the women, they have extremism when it comes to the issue of refutations, and they claim that this is from the religion. So do you have any advice concerning this? The Shaykh said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade us from exaggeration and extremism in the Quran itself. So Allah said, Ya Ahl al-Kitab, la taghlu fi dinikum. that, oh, people of the book, do not exaggerate and go to an extreme in your religion. However, it's mentioned that the refutation of narrators is a part of this religion. But even that, we do not go to an extreme and exaggeration in the refutation of narrators. These refutations and appraisal of the narrators of hadith. So the exaggeration, what is it? It is to go beyond and to transgress the borders of this religion. For example, somebody who makes wudu 5 times, it doesn't suffice with making wudu once and that's enough. He wants to make it 5 times before he does something. So this is exaggeration and going beyond transgressing the boundaries of the religion. So Ibn Taymiyyah, he said that it's possible a scholar, a mujtahid, someone who can derive the rulings, it's possible that he might make a statement which is actually an innovation because he thought a particular hadith to be authentic, or because he thought that the issue of a certain affair was correct, and in actual fact there was another issue which was more correct than that. So as a consequence, he fell into making this interpretation which ended up being an innovation. But we don't start saying, that's it, he's an innovator therefore. And we don't drop him and finish him off as a consequence of this error he made because of this interpretation of him thinking that the hadith was authentic and it wasn't, or other than that. So now this is what the people, they do sometimes, they do it. So we hear people doing it with Sheikh Ubayd al-Jabiri, saying that's it, he's finished. And Shaykh Rabia, they say these things about them. So this is incorrect. And the shaitan, the shaykh says, has two valleys. He has two approaches. One is extremism and one is shortcoming. So the Ikhwan al-Muslimin, for example, they have this shortcoming. They say, you don't refute anyone, forget refutations. We don't speak about these people, these affairs. That's going to split the people, etc. We don't want to talk about these things. So they go to an extreme in terms of shortcoming. وَضِدُّهُمْ
مَنْهُمْ إسقاط العالم الذي عرف بالدعوة للسنة والتوحيد بالخطأ والخطأين والبدعة والبدعتين.
بس قصدي ذكرتم أحد.
قال الذهبي لو أسقطنا العالم بالبدعة والبدعتين لا قصى أن أسقطنا أناس مثل المندة في العالم الذي أظهر السنة والتوحيد ووقع منه الخطأ والخطأين فلا يبدع ولا يتكلم في الكلام هذا إلا أهل العلم الصغار من الشابات والشابات يمسكوا ألسنتهم ويطلبوا العلم.
So that's one side, the Ikhwan al-Muslimin, they have a shortcoming in the affair. And then the other side, you have the extreme ones. The ones who go around saying that people are innovators for one or two errors here and there. An individual might make one error, two errors, and they go around saying, that's it, he's an innovator. They go to an extreme like that. And Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, he said that if that's the approach we were going to take, then we would have made innovators people like Ibn Manda. We would have said, he's an innovator as well then. So it's upon the youth, that they control themselves in this affair and they seek knowledge so they understand what they are saying and speaking about, and not to fall into either side, neither shortcoming and neither extremism in the affair.
تقول أم زوجي لها 80 سنة وعنده عائلة في اليمن 6 أولاد وعنده عائلة في بريطانيا 3 أولاد زوجة أخرى. هل يبقى في بريطانيا مع أمه وهي 80 في سن كبيرة في السن أو تروح إلى اليمن وهي كافرة هنا في بريطانيا؟
يبقى مع أمي أو إيش؟
يعني عنده 6 أولاد في اليمن وعنده زوجة أخرى هنا 3 أولاد وأمه هنا 80 سنة عندها كافرة، هل يبقى هنا ولا يروح إلى اليمن؟
إيه نعم، يبقى الرجل مع أمه ويصاحبها في الدنيا معروفا قبل أن تموت، لقوله تعالى وصاحبهما في الدنيا معروفة، ولقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما سئل من أحق الناس بحسن صحابتي قال أمك ثم أمك ثم أمك، ولم يقل إذا كانت مسلمة. نعم، فهذا وقد قال شيخ الإسلام من كانت أمه تعيش مع إنسان بالحرام عياذا بالله، قال هل أصلها؟ يقول السائل شيخ الإسلام قال لو كانت أمك على الشرك مأمور بمصاحبتها، فكيف بالزنا وهو دون الشرك؟ فابقى مع والدتك وبرها وألن القول لها كإبراهيم ما كان يقول يا أبتي لما تعبد ما لا يسمع ولا يبصر ولا يغني عنك شيئا، فتلطف معها في القول لعل الله يهديها، وادعو لها في وقت إجابة الدعاء. نعم، واستغفر وأكثر من ذلك، وألح على الله في ساعة الإجابة والسجود وأدبار الصلاة قبل السلام لعل الله يهديها.
The questioner says, my husband's mom is 80 years old and he has a family in Yemen with 6 children and he has a family here in the UK with 3 children. Should he stay in Britain with his mother or and she is alone and not a Muslim? So the Shaykh says, yes, he should do that. He should stay in England with his mother, who is old and not a Muslim, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, صَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا, that accompany them in this world in goodness. And then in a hadith, when it was said that who is more deserving of my companionship, then the Prophet said, your mother, your mother, your mother. And it was not constricted to the mother being Muslim, even if it was a disbelieving mother. And then Ibn Taymiyyah, on one occasion, another example, he was asked by an individual that my mother, she lives with a man who is not permissible for her. So should I accompany her or not? So Ibn Taymiyyah said to him that even if she was a mushrika, she was a disbeliever, you would still have to accompany her, let alone just fornication. Fornication is less than shirk. And also the Shaykh gives examples of Ibrahim alayhi salam in the Quran when he speaks, then he says, ya abati such and such, ya abati such and such. So this is the good manners and the kind manners that Ibrahim alayhi salam spoke to his father with. So this is how you should be this is how that individual should be towards his mother, and call her to Islam, and make dua at the times when the dua is answered, and be good to her. That maybe Allah will guide her to Islam.
طيب إذا نصلي الآن نصلي نصلي يعني الظاهر إنه يعني بعد الصلاة وين نصلي الآن كل مزدحمين أنت فقط نحن موجودين ولا في جو الناس يصلون
لا من الرجال إحنا بس
فقط نصلي هنا إذا أي نعم لهم يأتموا بينا هم وراءنا
هم أمامنا
ها طيب إذا يصلوا خلفنا يلا بعد الطاولة نصلي هم يصلون وراءه ما في ذا قبلة إيه نعم طيب يعني أمرنا النساء الآن للصلاة صلوا معشر النساء إلى جهة القبلة لأن الإمام وراءكم نعم فصلينا الآن إلى جهة القبلة
واحدة أمهم
إيه نعم واحدة أمكم وسطكن تقعنا وسطكن نعم
في الوسط
اي نعم وسطكن وصففنا واقمنا الصلاه وصلينا انتن ونحن نصلي هنا
The Sheikh says that the women they should pray dhuhr now. You should pray dhuhr alone yourselves because we're behind you, so it's not possible for us to lead. So you yourselves, one of you should lead the prayer and pray, and she should stand in the middle at the front and the rest of them on the sides and pray your dhuhr now. And another thing we'll quickly just mention, somebody texts me now saying that Oxford homeschooling lets you study from home, key stage 3 to GCSE and A-levels. So someone has put that forward, that Oxford homeschooling allows you to do that. Okay. But you should pray now.